brother sick in the shut in, Mother Marcia Frazier. Amen. We are Facebook Live. Somebody turn around and say, hey, Mother Frazier.
Hey, Mother Frazier.
Mother Frazier's watching live, amen, as we're streaming. And so we want to invite her, amen, to be a part of this great worship experience. All of those that are with us as we're streaming live, that we welcome them into this house as well, because the same anointing that's in this room, amen, is the anointing that God's going to use to touch them right where they are. So we're excited about what God is doing in this space. And it's connected, amen, through the World Wide Web. So we praise God for that. Amen. So we are now ready to receive, amen, the word of God. So we can stand now as we prepare to read from the book of Daniel, the 6th chapter, verses 10 through 22, in the New King James Version of God's word. Amen. And I thank God for our multimedia ministry, Brother Keel this morning, who's on point, Sister Nicole, amen, for the work that God is doing through them. Amen. Y'all thank God for the multimedia ministry. Amen. The words for the praise team, everybody, the choir is not up there, the scripture's up there, amen. You stopped bringing your Bible a long time ago, so thank God, amen, for the words being on the wall, amen. Amen. So you can follow us along, amen. 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 I tell my kids, don't play with me, you know who you are. The word of the Lord declares in Daniel, the 6th chapter, verse 10 through 22. These words. Now when Daniel knew that the writing was signed, he went home, and in his upper room, with his windows open toward Jerusalem, he knelt down on his knees 3 times that day and prayed and gave thanks before his God, as was his custom since early days. Then these men assembled and found Daniel praying and making supplication before his God. And they went before the king and spoke concerning the king's decree. Have you not signed a decree that every man who petitions any god or man within 30 days, except you, O king, shall be cast into the den of lions? The king answered and said, the thing is true, according to the law of the Medes and Persians, which does not alter. So they answered and said before the king, that Daniel, who is one of the captives from Judea, does not show due regard for you, O king, or for the decree that you have signed, but makes his petition 3 times a day. And the king, when he heard these words, was greatly displeased with himself, and set his heart on Daniel to deliver him. And he labored till the going down of the sun to deliver him. Then these men approached the king and said to the king, know, O king, that it is the law of the Medes and Persians that no decree or statute which the king establishes may be changed. So the king gave the command, and they brought Daniel and cast him into the den of lions. But the king spoke, saying to Daniel, your God, whom you serve continually, he will deliver you. Then a stone was brought and laid on the mouth of the den, and the king sealed it with his signet, his own signet ring, and with the signets of his lords, that the purpose concerning Daniel might not be changed. Now the king went to his palace and spent the night fasting, and no musicians were brought before him. Also his sleep went from him. Then the king arose very early in the morning and went in haste to the den of lions. And when he came to the den, he cried out with a lamenting voice to Daniel. The king spoke, saying, to Daniel, Daniel, servant of the living God, has your God, whom you serve continually, been able to deliver you from the lions? Then Daniel said to the king, O king, live forever. My God sent his angel and shut the lions' mouth, so that they have not hurt me, because I was found innocent before him, and also, O king, I have done no wrong before you. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated.
Fall in love.
Thank you.
these verses, and I could choose any one of them as a focus verse, but one, man, to choose, amen, just one where we can drop our bucket this morning and talk with you, amen, from a what I believe to be a, the beginning of a series of subjects that we can find relief and breakthroughs. And so I just want to ask the question, is your God able? That's what the Word declares. That's what the Word declares. That's what the king asked Daniel. And I want to talk with you from this subject. God moves in the tough places. God moves in the tough places. One thing is for certain brothers and sisters today, you need to know this for a fact. God is always moving. If you read your Bible, it never says that God stood still. He just tells you to stand still. Because if we don't stand still, we'll get in God's way. Amen. A lot of times we move before God says move, or we jump out in front of him and we get in his way, and then God can't do what he's ordained already to be done. So we got to learn to be still and know. Tell your neighbor, be still and know.
Be still and know.
Everything about God is important for us to understand, and we're not going to get it all today. Do understand that. I'm not going to be able to put it all in your spirit today, but what I do want to put in your spirit is that God moves in the tough places. How many have ever been in a tough place before? I'm going to take a deep breath and a sigh of relief, but it seems like whatever is going on around you, amen, it seems overwhelming. It seems like it's going to be more than you can handle or more than you can bear. And then all of a sudden, at some point in time, there's a breath of fresh air, amen, that God allows you to breathe in. And y'all remember that movie, Waiting to Exhale? You held it in so long until you couldn't let it out, and then finally God says, breathe. But when you breathe, the situation is still there. Circumstance is still on you, and the issue is still pushing you. But what I need for you to understand is God is able to step into wherever you are and bring you peace. And we celebrate Matthew the 8th chapter when Jesus stands at the helm of the ship and says, "Peace, be still." Because at that time he shows his power over nature when he speaks to the winds and the waves. But we have winds and waves that are blowing in our lives right now. That's why we get excited when we hear my soul has been anchored in the Lord, because if the winds don't cease, and if the winds don't stop blowing in my life, my soul, and then we forget that in order for us to be anchored in the Lord, that we have to go through a storm so that God can keep us anchored.
Amen.
I grew up in the South where the major industry was shipbuilding. And in that area, the Ingalls Shipbuilding Company has built probably more than half of the fleet for the United States Navy. The submarines, the battleships, the destroyers, the cruisers. I learned about all of the vessels that we have in our U.S. Navy through the work that they were doing over at Ingalls. And what I did not know, though, was once the ship came off of the dry dock, where they put in all of the things together, they put it into the water, when a hurricane or a major storm comes, they cannot leave the ship anchored or connected to the docks, because the ship will be damaged if it's connected to the docks during the storm. So what they do is they take the ship out into the middle of the hurricane and drop anchor in order to save the ship. So that means that anybody that's on the ship is going through a storm because they're trying to save the ship. So if they go out into the middle of the storm to save the ship, sometimes God has got to send a storm our way so that he can save us. Because it's through the storm that we learn how strong God is in our lives. Oh, y'all not hearing me, but it's all good. I know what I'm talking about. And so if we have to experience a sickness, or we have to lose a loved one, or we have to have a calamity that we weren't expecting, in order for God to show us that he's the strength of our lives. And as long as we keep our souls anchored in him, God is going to take care of us, even in the midst of the storm. So we have a situation today. I want you to know that God's move is intentional, is deliberate, and is divine. God's move is intentional, deliberate, and divine. If you remember Genesis, the 12th chapter, the Bible says God came to Abram and he told him to get away from your family, get away from your friends, get away from your father's house, and go to a place that I will show you. It doesn't look like God is moving, but God is moving when he moved Abraham into the place that he needed him to be. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
God is moving. So he set up Abram to become Abraham, to become the father of many nations, to become the person that would ultimately set up the pathway for the Lord Jesus to come. So that's the move of God, is divine. God has to move us. Amen. God moved on David when he told Samuel to go to Bethlehem, and he had prepared a king for his people, and he sent Samuel to Bethlehem to anoint David. That was the move of God. He pushed Samuel out of his comfort zone and into the place that he needed to be in order for the works of God to be done. Most importantly, God is divine. You remember now, when Moses was born in the book of Exodus, the Bible says that his mother hid him as long as she could, but there was a decree for every child under the age of 2 years old to be killed. Moses was about 3 months old, and his mother took and she created this basket, and she put him in the basket and put him on the Nile River. And the move of God was that as he drifted down the Nile, it just so happens that Pharaoh's daughter was coming to take her bath, and she heard the baby crying. She pulled him from the water and called his name Moses, and the name Moses means to be drawn out of. So God draws you out of a situation to plant your feet in another situation so that he can prepare you for another situation.
Amen.
And so as we go forward, Jesus himself was even in danger. The Bible says after Jesus was born, that the angel of the Lord came to Joseph and Mary and said, get thee out of Bethlehem and get to Egypt, because the decree is all of the kids 2 years old and younger ought to be killed. And so in order to protect Jesus, who was divine, who was the Son of God, but in the reality of protecting him, God had to move him in order to protect him. Every now and then, God's got to move you and hide you somewhere for your own sake. And you got to be open to the move of God. God was trying to move Lot and his family out of Sodom. God knew that he was going to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah, and he wanted to move Lot and his family. So he sent word for Lot and his family to get out of Sodom, because destruction was coming. They delayed, they hesitated. The Bible says the angel had to push them out. But as they got to the skirt on the edge of the city, Lot's wife, who didn't want to let go, she turned and looked. The Bible says she turned into a pillar of salt. My word for you today is stop trying to hold on to your past. If God is trying to move you out of it, keep on pushing, baby. Don't go back and don't worry about what's behind you. So you gotta be open to the move of God. You can't be worried about what you got in your suitcase. Amen. Peter was in prison, and the Bible says the angel of the Lord appeared unto him and told him, get out, Peter, we gotta move. And the Bible says that Peter was taking his time, putting on his shoes and putting on his coat, and the angel says, move, man. Because we don't have a whole lot of time. The move of God is not based on your time. The move of God is based on the window that God has created. And if you don't know how to get through the window quick like that in a hurry, the window may close. And you don't know how long before God sends another window. Amen. And some of us have missed the window, or more importantly, the move of God. And so now we're stuck in a place that God had already designed to move us away from. So we got to be ready to move when God says move.
Yeah.
You need to understand something, that this brother Daniel is in a peculiar situation. Last week we talked about situations, amen. Y'all remember last week's situation, amen.
Yeah.
Talk about circumstances and what a circumstance is. A circumstance is one finding themselves in a particular situation. I mean, finding themselves in a condition that is connected to a relevant event. That's what a circumstance is, connected to a relevant event. Relevant means right now. What does that mean? That means my rent is due right now. Tell your neighbor, that's relevant.
That's
I love church. I love praising God. I love giving God the glory. But my rent is due right now. Amen. Yeah. Woo! My man sang it. Woo! Gary was playing. Dwight was on it. Man, they was lifting him up. I heard the angels while they were singing. But my rent is due. The dots, we don't see worship
as a way for God to empower us and encourage us, and in the midst of our circumstance, God is still moving. And if I put my focus on God and not my circumstance, when God moves, I won't miss him. Because God already knows what he's going to do for me right now. But don't be mistaken. If I haven't done what I was supposed to do, then I should not expect God to do what he said he would do. So it's something that we are responsible for. So I want to talk about some three things. I'm going to step on here because I want to make sure that we get them today. And so Daniel is in a peculiar situation. Daniel, my main man, Daniel, my God, Daniel. It's the guy of this time, man. He's one of those fellows, amen, that you've heard about all of your life, and you've heard about this particular situation. But I need for you to hear some things about Daniel, amen, that are important to our lives today. This sermon, for me, was an encouragement. So I ask God to help me to prepare it in a way where it encourages all of us.
Amen.
But it's individual. Because right now, we're individually going through some things. Amen. I know we're here collective, we're in a congregation, but there are some of us that are going through some situations right now. And we need to hear a word from the Lord. I love my sister. Man, I'm grateful for my brother. What up, dog? But I need to hear a word from the Lord right now. Because when I go back home, there's some things that I got to deal with, and my dog ain't going to be there with me. And the girly girls, I don't know what I'm going through. I got to hear a word from the Lord today. And the Lord says today, I will move even in the tough places. And what I need to understand is when God gets ready to move in your life, he shakes stuff up. And we don't like shaking up, because when God makes us uncomfortable, we don't know how to respond. And a lot of us, we run when we're uncomfortable rather than stay planted. But we need to know why we're staying planted, because God's getting ready to do something. And when God gets ready to shake it up, only things that are not of God begin to rattle. But the things that are of God become solid.
Yeah.
So the question today is, are you solid or are you rattling? For a minute, I thought I was rattling. Amen. Here's why I thought I was rattling, because for a moment, we talked about it in class this morning. For a moment, sometimes when the enemy shows up, we forget we saved. Mm-hmm. And somebody said, "How do you forget you saved, Pastor?" Because the flesh is so strong at times, it will make you think you have lost your mind when you really haven't. The flesh is so strong sometimes, it will make you forget what your name is. Depending on the level of the attack, your flesh will make you dive off of something in an effort to satisfy it. And you won't even know you tried to commit suicide. That's how strong the flesh is. A lot of times we downplay the flesh because we dressed it up. Because we bathed it. Because we clothed it. Because we beat it with makeup. We did it. We think we got the flesh under control. But even Paul says, after I have preached, Lord, give me the strength to keep my flesh under subjection. Because if the right person show up at the wrong time, well, y'all, it ain't going to stop cussing, amen. Give God the glory. But there are some people, amen, that show up. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
But you need to get it out of my face. Have you ever been in a situation when somebody was agitating you so bad, you start looking down and start counting? Person, what you count for? 12, 11, 10, 9. You hoping God moves by the way before you get to 0, amen. Because if you make it to 0, it's over. Y'all ain't never been in that situation. I'm just talking about me, kid. Amen. It's all good. So three things come to mind about Daniel that I need for you to hear. As we're being encouraged this morning, I need for you to
hear why it's important for us to hear how Daniel is being described. Because in order for Daniel to really understand what's going on in his life right now, Daniel has to have a relationship with God. You cannot be in tough places and not have a relationship with God. Because your faith in God is what keeps you in the midst of the storm.
Amen.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Now, Daniel here, and we've heard this story so much that we really don't dig deep into what's behind the scenes. And what you'll find is, a lot of times you read books and you don't know the substratum. You don't know the basis for which or why a person wrote the book. What's the backstory? How many of you know the backstory is the most important part of the story?
Oh, yeah.
You need to know why it's been written. Why is he saying that? Why is this happening? Why are we involved in this situation right now? That's a backstory. And unless you know the backstory, you'll never understand why you're going through what you're going through. The problem is that when I don't understand the backstory, I don't know that God is doing something in my life. Because God is bringing me out of something. And I don't even know I was in something. But a lot of times, if you don't know you're in it, you don't know if God is bringing you out of it. And you don't even know when you're out of it because you didn't know you were in it. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
I didn't even know I was in trouble until the bank called. Amen. Y'all missing. Amen. I sit on different committees, praise God, for all those assignments. But I've heard people say, I didn't even know we were poor until somebody told me we were poor. So we're dealing with this whole thing called poverty, and people don't even realize they live in poverty. You thought potted meat was the best thing that ever happened to you. But you didn't realize you was eating potted meat and devil ham and sardines and the sausages because you were poor. Amen. You didn't have the money to buy the other things. You got steak every now and then. You went to McDonald's once a week. Amen. Right now, we go every day. It's a luxury that we have, but the days when we really didn't have that, you were satisfied with the butter, beans, and peas all mixed together with a little okra and a little sausage in the between. Amen. And if you got a sausage and the red beans, we thank God for a little rice to make it stretch.
Amen.
Mama would have beans for 3 days and make a new batch of cornbread every day and make it look like a new meal. But ain't this what we had yesterday?
Yeah.
And now that kid don't eat leftovers, neither do you, because you say God has brought you out. You arrived. You don't have to eat leftovers. But I thank God for the leftovers because that's how the stomach got full. Amen. You slice that meat off 2 or 3 days and wrap it up, put it in the refrigerator for tomorrow, and put a different vegetable with it because it's a new meal. Why am I eating oxtails? Why am I eating neck bone?
Yeah.
Mama bought about 3 packages of neck bones because we know the neck bones won't last till Wednesday. Then she would make gravy the second day off the neck bones. Now you got rice and gravy and neck bones. Y'all ain't saying anything. Listen, I'm just trying to help you. Tough times.
Amen.
And his move is so awesome, you don't even know you're going through something unless somebody tells you.
Yeah.
I love the text because Daniel is the focus of the text, but really, Daniel is not. Daniel, y'all, is about 80 years old about this time. You would think at 80, wouldn't nobody be messing with you? You done lived your life, you done everything you thought you could do to help people. And you mean to tell me at 80, we still got enemies?
Yeah.
At 80, we still got people that are jealous of us?
Oh, yeah.
I need you to understand, as long as you're in the will of God,
Say that.
You die, the enemies will always be coming after you.
Yeah.
The enemy don't care how old you are.
Right.
I ain't found anywhere in the Bible where the devil stopped moving and working because of somebody's age. So the text teaches us that the enemy is going to always be after you. And the backstory is, I need to know what the anointing or the call of God is on my life so that I know why the enemy is still coming after me. Because God did something in my life early on that the enemy caught wind of it. And since that time, the enemy has been trying to take me out.
Yeah.
I need for you to know from your birth until now, the enemy
who understands God's will for your life and God's purpose for your life is on the attack. The Bible says Jesus warns us and says that he comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. The challenge that we face is he says, but I come that you might have life. So he gives us an option. But the option is either you're going to be chased by the devil and not have a covering, or you're going to be chased by the devil and have a covering.
Say that. Say
but what he tells you is you'll never stop being chased by it.
Here's what they say about Daniel that is important that helps us to understand why the move of God is so important. In verse number 2 of this text, text says, and I'll read it for you really quickly. I'm not yet verse number 2. I don't even have a book that you know, I stopped bringing my Bible because I don't have a New King James translation. Kill, you got verse number 2? I didn't put verse number 2 on him, so he's having my Bible. He's going to pull it up in a minute. And I'm going to read it so you can hear it. I'll read verse 2 and 3. And over these three presidents, of whom Daniel was first, that the princes might give account unto them, and the king should have no damage. Next verse for me. Then this Daniel was preferred above the presidents and princes because an excellent spirit was in him. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Bless you. Y'all say amen for the reverend. Amen.
Amen.
Who came to rescue the pastor? Amen.
Amen.
Tell your neighbor, you gotta have an excellent spirit. Y'all thought amen, it was something else amen, but it was Daniel's choice how he was going to live his life, and that's what makes the difference in your life, not what people do for you or what you do for people. What makes the difference in your life is when you understand that God has a call on your life and he puts it in your spirit. The precious jewel here is that Daniel, who is in captivity, and he's in captivity, y'all, since he was a boy, but yet, because of the anointing on his life, God gave him an excellent spirit, and from the day he arrives in Babylon until long after he's 80 and 90, the spirit of Daniel is what gives room for Daniel to move even in the midst of the tough times. It's your spirit that God works through, not your profession, not your money, not your house, not your job. God works through your spirit. And if your spirit is connected to God's spirit, everything that you need, God will provide through the spirit. He's connected to God in the spirit realm. And God gives him an excellent spirit. Say excellent.
Excellent.
The word excellent here means a preeminent. A preeminence means it surpasses all others. It's distinguished. God sets him apart from everybody else. Even in the midst of the storm, God can set you apart from everybody else. And when everybody else is going through, people want to know why you're being blessed. Here's what we learn from the New Testament is that as the people of God, as the children of God, the Bible says we're sanctified. Say sanctified.
Sanctified.
We're set apart from the world, which means that there should be a distinguishing difference between you and the person that's in the world so that they will see the difference in your attitude, in your spirit, and your work. If they can't tell the difference, then it's something wrong with the way you're presenting yourself because you've been called of darkness into the marvelous light. Daniel had a distinguishable difference about his spirit that everybody took note of, even the king. Watch this. When you do what God has called you to do and you walk in your purpose, nobody can stop you from being promoted.
Amen.
That was encouraging for me. Amen. Because the excellence in his spirit explains how and why he's being described as a man that is faithful. Your spirit determines your faithfulness. If you don't understand what God is doing in your life, if you don't comprehend what God has done for you and why he put you where you are, then you cannot be faithful.
So the reason why Daniel is able to deal with the situation that he's going through is not because of his age, it's because of his spirit. Amen. And the Bible says he has been faithful. Say faithful.
Faithful.
Which means that Daniel didn't just start being faithful. The text wants us to know that Daniel's been faithful from the beginning. When Daniel first got into Babylon as a child, and they tried to give Daniel the king's favor, and they tried to make Daniel look like everybody else in the kingdom, Daniel said, "No, I want you to give me a chance. Let me do what my God has taught me to do. Let me use the diet that my God has given me. And you watch and see, don't I look better than the ones you're feeding from the king's table?" Why? Because Daniel knew if I eat the poison from the king's table, it's going to change who I am. But if I keep myself sanctified,
yeah,
when I go through this storm, I will still be distinguishable.
Yeah.
The Bible says God gave him gifts. Say gifts.
Yeah.
To interpret dreams and visions.
Yeah.
And if you read in Proverbs 18, chapter 16, chapter 18, verse, or 18, chapter 16, verse, it says, "And a man's gifts will make room for him."
Amen.
So that means that you got to learn the value of your gift. Because it's your gift that God's going to use to move you forward.
Yeah.
A lot of people are not moving because they don't understand their gifts.
Amen.
We're doing stuff, but is it our gift?
Amen.
I have the ability to do this, but is it my gift?
Mm-hmm.
I like doing that, but is it your gift?
Amen.
If you still sew in the arm where the leg's supposed to be, then maybe being a seamstress is not.
Amen.
I know they still buying their clothes and they're wrong. I'm gonna tell you they're wrong. Because if they know it don't look good and they ain't gonna wear it, they're just gonna take it home and throw it away, they are giving you the wrong impression that the work that you're doing is good. You know what I learned? We hurt people by lying to them.
Yes.
Yeah. Let me say that again.
Yeah.
We hurt people by lying to them.
Yeah.
We hurt our kids by lying to them.
Yeah.
Ooh, baby, that's pretty.
Yeah.
Well, you know it's her. It's better for you to say, "Let's keep working," because excellence is about working hard. That's encouragement.
Yeah.
But to say, "Ooh, that's a pretty bitch, mama, put it out on there, stop lying." Because you know what's going to happen? Maybe you're going to come to work with you one day and you forget that you put that junk in the drawer.
Uh-oh.
Huh? I can tell you what I'm talking about. I ain't just got a bit of that, amen. My kids used to do stuff and they used to give it to me to put up at work and they never got up at work, amen. I told them I was going to put up at work, but I didn't put it up at work, amen. Because at 8, you can't be scribbling scratching, amen. You got to be colored in the lies. If you still color out the lies at 8, it's something wrong. I ain't gonna try to promote that mess either, no. A daddy wants you to color red in this box that says red. Don't give me blue where it says red, because somebody won't see that. Tell you that you gotta be faithful. To be faithful means to be honest. To be faithful means to be courageous. To be faithful means to be straightforward.
Yeah.
Daniel had a gift to interpret dreams. And God used his gift to be able to speak to the king, to give the king instructions on how to live his life. If you're going to be faithful, you're going to be a faithful servant, you got to be honest, you got to have integrity, you got to be courageous, you got to be sold out to God. Because God's going to use you to change other people's lives.
Yeah. Yeah.
You can't be inconsistent and undependable and be faithful at the same time. Our whole marriage is built on faithfulness. Being there when I need you. Being honest. Being transparent.
Amen.
Being courageous. Being committed. That's what faithfulness is.
Yeah.
Being dedicated to what you've been called to do.
Yeah.
That's what faithfulness is. And to be faithful means that I'm in it to win it.
Yeah.
And that nothing is going to take me away from the assignment that God has given me. That's what we need to hear from Daniel. Daniel says, "I'm committed. I'm going to be faithful. Even though I've been captivity, even though my life seems like it's over, I recognize that I'm a child of God. And in the midst of the tough times, being a child of God doesn't change, because God promised that he would take care of me, that he would Daniel is faithful. He has an excellent spirit. And that he is faithful. Which means that he hasn't allowed his situation and circumstance to drain him of what God has put in him. You can't allow what the world is doing against you to take you out of the will of God.
That's right. Say that. Say
because when the tough times come, the world won't be able to help you. Psalms 121, we know it very clearly. It says, I look to the hills from whence cometh my help. My help coming from the Lord. For a long time, I didn't read that right. It's really in a question. I look to the hills from whence cometh my help. Does my help come from the Lord?
Yeah.
Here's the reason why the writer asked the question. Because in Jerusalem, Jerusalem was in a valley. And the valley was surrounded by hills. And when they got in trouble or there was warfare, the hills protected them from their enemy. So that when the enemy came down into Jerusalem or Judea, the hills is where the help came from. So those that were coming to help them came out of the hills. So the writer says, does my help really come from the hills or does my help come from the Lord? My help coming from the Lord. It doesn't come through the hills. It comes from the Lord.
Amen.
So when I'm in the valley on top, as long as I look to the Lord, everything is going to be all right.
Amen.
You know, you got to think about that. It's real. It's real. Stop looking at people. Start looking to the Lord.
Amen.
Don't worry about your circumstances. As long as you're in the will of God, God has already declared that he's going to take care of you.
Amen.
He's already declared he's going to provide for you. He's already declared that he was going to cover you. So you got to keep looking to the Lord. David said, I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praise shall continually be. I can't stop thinking because I'm going through something, because as long as I thank him, I'm going to get through whatever I'm going through. Thanking God is a form of your breakthrough.
Yeah.
Giving God the praise in the midst of your storm is how you get through it. God moves in the tough time.
Yeah.
Paul and Silas are in jail, and their fate is not even clear, but Silas do is important to us. They begin to praise God at midnight, and while they're praising God, the Bible says the chains fell off and the doors opened. You need to understand is when you give God praise, no matter what's around you, no matter what's going on, the chains are going to fall off and God's going to open the door, and you got to have enough sense to walk through that door.
Yeah.
Woo.
Yeah.
Some of us have been in our situation so long that when God opens the door, we don't even recognize it. Excuse me, that the reason why they chain up animals is so that they will always give them a mind that they are in captivity. So much so that when the animal is grown, it's been chained up for so long that when the chain comes off, the animal has no desire to run away. Some of us are in captivity right now. We've been in our situation so long. When God gets ready to move and open the door, we have no desire to run. Somebody has told us we ain't gonna never be nothing. We ain't gonna never go nowhere. We ain't gonna never amount to nothing. And you believed it all your life. And so now that God has given you a breakthrough, God is moving in your life, you can't even muster up enough strength to get out from under the dark clouds of the words of negativity. Because the enemy has been pouring in your head for so long. The enemy has trapped us because we, who are insecure about who God is in our lives, have become a target for the enemy. We talked about it in class this morning. There are so many of us that's got a Penina in our lives who is our adversary from the inside. The Bible says in 1 Samuel, the first chapter, around verse number 3, that Penina, the adversary of Hannah, she got at her every day until Hannah had no more joy left. Some of y'all are living with people who are your adversary.
Well, say that.
And Hannah went to worship every year. But she got to a point because of what her enemy was doing, she couldn't even worship God anymore. But she was still going. There are too many people that are just coming to church and have no desire to worship because of the hell you're going through at home. We come to church and we have no desire to worship because of what we're dealing with on our jobs. We have a desire to worship, but we don't know how to worship because the enemy is so strong where we are. We don't even believe that God has already given us victory. We don't even realize that the works of the Lord have already been done on our consistent. He's always there.
Yes.
The Bible says, the eyes of the Lord are every place, beholding the good and evil. He never leaves me. He's faithful. No, he's faithful. He's faultless. Means his attitude is right.
Yes.
He knows no error. He's not perfect, but he's faultless. He recognizes that the things that I do will reflect on the God that I serve.
All right.
It's in your attitude.
Yes.
Some of us are struggling with our attitudes. Our attitude is an outward manifestation or reflection of what's in our heart.
Amen.
So if you got a bad attitude, you got a bad heart. If you got a good attitude, even when somebody around you got a bad attitude, it might mean you got a pretty good heart.
Well,
the Bible says, out of the mouth, the heart speaks.
Amen.
So if you're cussing me out, cussing is a part of who you are.
Yeah.
If you're rolling your ass at me all the time, then out rolling is a part of who you are.
Yeah.
If you're sassing people off and snapping at people all the time, then sass and snap is who you are.
Yeah.
If you're beating up people all the time, yourself, then beaten up is a part of who you are. But if you're praising God in the midst of your storm, then praise might be who you are. If you're worshiping God no matter what's going on around you, then a worshiper might be who you are. It's all about the condition of your heart. And the attitude that you have is a reflection of what's in your heart. If you learn how to praise God in season and out of season, when you're going through and when you're not going through. When you're up and when you're down. When God gets ready to move, you already got your tool built. And you just pull out a tool that works for you. What's going on right now? It's hard. I got to get a little prayer out here. So I'm going to pull the prayer out of my tool belt. This crazy person keeps talking to me funny. I'm going to pull a love out of my tool belt. I'm going to have a little joy in the back of my belt. I got a little peace on this side. And I'm going to just slide out in the midst of my storm. Whatever I do, I'm going to hold. Make it, I can't let the devil pull me out of my character. I'm one of those, amen, that has not reached the level of give the other cheek.
Say that. Say that.
Thank you, Jesus.
Being honest. Being honest.
So I'm just going on record. If you slap me, I'm letting you know I ain't there yet. I'm trying, but tell you, babe, I'm trying.
I'm trying.
I'm learning though. I'm almost there. I'm almost there. I may not hit you right away. But if I think about it long enough, without going into prayer, without fasting and singing a song, let her go. All the glory belongs to you. You got to go into worship real fast because the flesh is going to come in and tell you, you better not let them hit you like that. Don't you let them treat you like that. And if you're not strong enough to have the right attitude, the devil will pull you out of your character and they will have you on the front page. Pastor abuses him.
Yeah.
And baby, you gotta learn how to be fearless.
Yeah.
The Bible says they came against Daniel, not physically. But they said, if we want to trap this brother, we got to get him where it hurts. We have to make him deny his God. Somebody got to know you strong. And the only way that they can break you down is to bring you out of the presence of God. But you got to be fearless, and you got to know that no matter what happens, I'm not going to let anything separate me from the love of God through Christ Jesus. Not height, not depth, not angel, not principality, not beauty, not him, not her, not job, not no job, not money, not no money. Nothing's going to come between me and God. Whether I got it or I don't got it, I have learned those to be a base and a bound. Whatever state I'm in, I got to learn how to be content in God.
That's right.
So they come after Daniel and they say, here's how we're going to get it. We're going to tell the king. Can't nobody pray to nobody for 30 days but you, man, you're the best. Ain't nobody better than you, King Darius. You dog. Let's stop all this madness. People got to pray to you, man, because you're the king. Because Darius was a despot monarch, which means that he made all of the decisions. That there was nobody higher than him. Nobody could change what he said, and nobody could say what he didn't want to change. Because of that, they used his arrogance against him. And they made him sign a decree that no matter what, watch this, y'all. The laws of the Babylonians were different than the laws of the Medes and the Persians. Daniel was consistent with different kings. But as long as Daniel was faithful and Daniel was faultless, God transcended him above the laws of the land. Here's what happens. The law changed. And when Darius came along to sign the decree, they said, because the law of the Medes and the Persians is that you can't change it once you sign it. But because he was caught up in arrogance, he didn't even read what he was signing. Sometimes people move out and don't recognize what damage they are about to do. Don't let that worry you. As long as you're faithful and faultless and fearless, know that God is going to be with you. Watch this and I'm done. He signed it, and then they said, Daniel is the one. I love the text, Sister Dale, because the Bible says when Daniel realized that the writing had been signed, he went home, went into his upper room, opened the windows, and prayed to God three times that day. They were watching him from a distance because they knew how faithful he was. They knew that he was faultless, but they didn't know he was fearless. They thought that they were going to get him and he was going to stop and they were going to break him and the king was going to see that he wasn't what he said he was. A lot of times the enemy just works to break you because people love you because of who you are and the enemy can't stand it. So the enemy works to discredit you and you got to be careful that you don't give in to the enemy's attempt to discredit you. Continue to be faithful in God and God will cover you. The Bible says that Daniel prayed three times that day. Tell your neighbor you got to pray. We don't know what he said. We just know what position he was in. He was more concerned about how God viewed him than his enemies. You can't be worried about what people say about you. Peter said, it's better for us to obey a God that is able to kill soul and man than to be worried about what you're going to do to me. Spring, they come in and arrest him. I love the text because guess what? They arrest him in front of everybody. By pulling him out of his house, everybody's on the streets. The enemy wants people to think that you have been broken. They pull him out in front of everybody, take him to the palace, and the king says this, Daniel, I'm sorry, but the law is the law. But don't you worry. The God that you serve continually is able to deliver you.
Amen.
Y'all missed it. Amen. The king said it to Daniel. Daniel didn't have to say it to the king. Somebody has got to know how faithful you are to your God. And when it comes time to speak up for you, they can say the things that God has already shown them, that you are faithful to your God. tough places. You got to live a life before him so that he can defend you in the hard times. Everybody stand. They put Daniel in the lion's den.
Yeah.
The king couldn't sleep again. He couldn't eat. Because he didn't have faith. Notice the difference between the king who said God is able and Daniel who said God is able. The king can't sleep. But Daniel is resting.
Yeah.
You gotta be able to rest in the middle of your storm.
Yes.
Right.
Because God will send a peace.
Yes, he will.
All y'all miss it. Amen.
Yes, he will.
Yeah.
To have an excellent spirit means surpassing all.
Oh.
God will send a peace that surpasses all. Understand.
Yes, yes.
It was because of Daniel's spirit that in the midst of tough times, God was able to meet him where he was.
Yeah.
The Bible says that God sent an angel to tell the lions, don't you dare touch me.
Yeah.
I'm standing here to cover him. I'm standing here between you and death. God will send an angel to stand between you and your trouble.
Yeah.
As long as you learn to be faithful, faultless, and fearless.
Yeah.
And when it's all said and done, the Bible says the next morning the king came down and what did he say? Daniel! What's your God able?
Yeah.
Part of him was